So what I wanted to go over today was some typical flag patterns, and I think this is really going to help you guys in the long run. So basically, I'm going to go over a few of the good stocks that were in the past week for plays. A few of them, or the three of them, being ANY. I'm sure a few of you have heard. Then FNJN just moved a little bit recently. And then I think I also did one, oh, on OPXAW, because of course everybody heard about that. It's huge pump and dump that happened, that big skyrocket it took off on. So I'm just kind of going to go over some of the patterns on the intraday chart so that way when you start to see them in real time, you know when to kind of get in on them. And then also on OPXAW, I did an analysis of the chart probably like 3 or probably about like a month ago. And I actually had the chart set up perfectly, and I missed its big move because I no longer was actually paying attention to it. But I'll show you how I set up the chart so that way you can kind of start catching those huge moves. So right now we're looking at ANY. And if you guys look on my screen where my cursor is at, I'm going to zoom in on the chart. Okay, now this was, I believe this was a couple days ago, but just for example, on its type of patterns, right? So, when you're looking at a 1 minute chart, so when we're talking intraday day trading, it's really good to have up two charts. On the left, I have a 1 minute chart time frame, and on the right, I have a 5 minute chart time frame. When you're day trading, it's really essential to have both the charts, 1 minute and 5 minute. And what I'm saying is a 1 day 1 minute and a 1 day 5 minute. And the reason you really want to have both the charts on the screen at the same time when you're looking at trading a stock is because sometimes setups are more clear on a 1 minute chart and sometimes they're more clear on a 5 minute chart. In a way, essentially, you may miss a move because it doesn't pop out at you on a 1 minute chart, but it pops out clear as day on a 5 minute chart. And that's why I have a 1 minute and a 5 minute up. So if you follow my cursor on the left, you'll see that, this thing went up. ANY popped up again, and then it popped up again, and popped up multiple times, three or four times, right? Now, on the 1 minute chart, it's not quite as clear. On the 1 minute chart, you might say, this thing's downtrending. There's no clear indicator of when to get in. But I have the little circle on my screen and the arrow pointing to where your entry point would have been on the 1 minute chart, and where on the right it would have been on the 5 minute. So as we go up, and you follow my cursor, your first entry point, and this is what you're looking at, is a pullback. Once the stock makes its move up, you always most likely are going to see some sort of sell-off, and usually that's people taking their profits from the move up. Now, your entry point on a 5 minute chart is much more clear than the 1 minute chart. On the 1 minute chart, it looks like it's selling off. But if you had the 5 minute chart up, you were able to see that it was just a little bit of sell-off here in a 5 minute candle. And your entry point would be this candle right here. Okay, you want the first green 5 minute candle to make a high above the previous red candle. That would be your entry point. You could have even gotten in on the second candle right here, but a clear, definite entry point would have been the first 5 minute candle to break above the previous red candle. And that would be your entry point, and you would have been able to catch this move up. Hold on, let me take this off real quick. You would have been able to catch, that would have been a 6% move, so not huge, but the bigger one would have been here. Now, as we go over to the second pullback, okay, we had this huge sell-off right here. So we had our first pullback, we spike up, we have our second pullback. The second pullback entry would have been here on the 1 minute chart, and it's just not clear on the 1 minute chart where the pullback is, but it's very clear right here. This would have been your entry point. Your first 5 minute candle to make a new high above its previous red candle. That shows you within a 5 minute trading time period, we're now becoming a bullish trend. We're now starting to trend upwards. Okay, so your first entry point. So on pullbacks, you're always looking for your green candle to make a new high above the previous red candle. So this one is specifically designed to show you pullbacks on a 5 minute chart and not so much on the 1 minute chart, because a 1 minute chart's just way too choppy. There's too much stuff going on. It's just not very clear. So let's go over it again. Pullbacks are essentially when you get a rise up in the stock and there's some type of sell off, it goes again, sells off, goes again, sells off, goes again. There could be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 pullbacks in one chart, but usually that's not the case. Usually you'll get 2 or 3 pullbacks. And it's always best to trade like the second, you know, maybe the second, first and second pullback. The third pullback tends to be a little less weak, and there's usually not as much room for profit making. As you can see, the first pullback was kind of small, but the second pullback was very big. And then the third pullback up here got up, you know, it was still substantially big, but not as big. So if you were to get in on your second pullback here, where you get the 5-minute candle, and I'm going to zoom in a little more. So on your second pullback, your entry point, first 5-minute candle to break above the previous red candle in the downtrend, in the pullback, is your entry point. If you got in right here, you would have been able to capitalize. I mean, that was about a 10% move if you sold right on the tippy-tippy top. You know, you could have even held through this pullback, and you would have looked at, you know, somewhere near almost a 20% move. But then again, if you got on the second pullback and you're looking at a 1-minute chart here, you know, you get on, you're looking at your 5-minute chart, you get the first 5-minute candle to break above that previous red, you're like, okay, I'm in, I'm going to go long. Now, if you look over on your 1-minute chart, it's just moving up, moving up, moving up. And if you see this type of sell-off on the 1-minute chart, you might get scared and get out, which a lot of people would. But if you look on the 5-minute chart, it's just one big red candle, which is also very nervous. Especially if this red candle practically engulfs the first green, that's almost a sure sign to get out, because if it keeps going, you're going to lose a lot of profits. So it's really, you know, for those of you trading on Robinhood, this is where it gets tricky, right? So as Robinhood, if you're using your day trades, you know, you only have 3 day trades if your account's less than 25K. With that being said, you know, a lot of us want to hold on to the stock as long as we can and let it get as extended as possible before we sell out, so we can make as much profit per one trade, knowing that we only have 2 more trades after this one for the rest of the week. Now, when you guys grow up and you get an account above 25K, your best bet is to get in on the pullback, sell on the move up, and then get out and wait for your second opportunity. Rather than holding through here, you want to get in again. So on your pullbacks, you want to get in, sell out, wait for your next pullback, get in, get out. You know, when you're working on Robinhood, it's just going to take time, and the best bet is just to take your profits while you get them. So what I would recommend doing is, if you're going to play pullbacks, which you really should, because they're very strong opportunities for, you know, making money, obviously, because there's so many traders that watch these type of moves that they're just, you get a lot of follow through. Okay, so I hope that's making sense for you guys. Now I'm going to go scroll over to the right. I believe I have another setup on this chart I wanted to talk about. Okay, right here, this is one. Let me scroll over on my 1-minute chart. Now, all these moves were just within the past week. So let's go over this one. Okay, this is still the stock ANY. This one popped up on my scanner in the morning for pre-market, and the reason it did that, well, A, because it was gapping up. Okay, it was making significant moves in the pre-market trading. It went from, you know, it moved up. Oh, it's not giving me one second. In pre-market alone, this thing went up 33%, a little higher than that. It actually went up 36%. So if a stock is going to go up and it's gapping up 36% pre-market, I'm very interested in that stock. I have my eyes set on that stock. And why is that? Because if a stock is going up 33% pre-market, people are trading it for one, usually, and that's gonna bring attention to other traders, not only myself, not only you guys, but many other traders are going to start noticing, hey, ANY is up 36% pre-market. Is there news behind it? You know, is there news driving this price up pre-market? If there is, fantastic. That just gives you more reassurance that the price of the stock is moving up based on good news. If a stock is moving up pre-market without any news, and you want to get in right at the opening bell, it makes it much more riskier and much trickier to do so, and it doesn't give you as much confidence to get in the trade that way, because there's nothing really backing the move in the pre-market. If there's news backing the move in the pre-market, it starts to make sense, okay? People are anticipating the stock to rise, you know, throughout the day or maybe throughout the gate because of the news. Okay, ANY just, who knows, made the cure for cancer. It's moving up 50-100% pre-market. That makes sense. What doesn't make sense is stocks that are just complete dog crap moving up, you know, pre-market and then shooting out the gates. It does happen, but you just need to start being more aware that you want to find the catalyst. You want to know whether or not the stock is moving up based on news. So with that being said, the stock goes up 30%, right? So I'm watching it. Right now, it's creating this flat top breakout. This flat top breakout is really basically happening right in front of my face or right in front of your face if you're watching it, right? So the stock is basically holding highs of this level right here, okay? It was basically holding those highs. And it had nice support right around here. It wasn't dropping below that support. It wasn't breaking above that high for, you know, a good amount of candles there. Maybe about 5 or 6 candles, 10 candles, whatever. So right out of the gate, what I would be looking for is a flat top breakout. Is this stock going to break above its previous highs, pre-market, or just what it's been holding? So this is what I would call an opening flat top breakout, or some people may call it a gap and go. Where the stock is gapping up, then right out of the gates, it just goes. So however you want to take it, you know, you could take this a flat top breakout or a gap and go. Either one is fine. If you're not sure what those are, you can easily Google it. There's tons of information out there. I'm sure you'll pick them up after I do enough of these videos. But you can see my circle right here, this little faded circle. That would be my entry point. And the reason that's my entry point, you know, I wouldn't have just traded right out of the gate until the stock broke above its pre-market highs or that little flat top area, right? The stock was basically saying it doesn't want to go above this line, tried to go there, tried to go here, and it failed to do so. But I'm sure if we get a break above that line, the stock is going to go. And sure enough, right out of the gates, it ripped up about 15, you know, if you sold it right at the tippy top, you're getting 18%. You know, if you sold on the way up, you know, if you sold in the middle, you're making a 9-10% move right out of the gates within, you know. And remember, this is a 1-minute chart. If you're going to be playing gap and goes, or you're going to be playing, you know, flat top breakouts right out of the gates in the market, you have got to be very quick, okay? Because the market moves so fast. So this is 1-2 minutes. So I would have only been in this trade for maybe 2 minutes at max, but probably a minute 40, minute 30 seconds, okay? And for those of you trading with Robinhood, if you're trying to get into this type of trading style, I'm sure some of you have experienced, I've experienced it. It doesn't happen very often, but it does happen where you'll put an order through and the order executes just fine, but it takes your phone a second to actually catch up and understand that the order's been processed. So you're waiting for your phone to load so that you can actually put in a sell order. That's happened to me, a few times, a handful of times where I put an order in, and then my phone takes a second to actually catch up and load a new screen for me to be able to put in my sell orders. And in that matter of time, the price could go up and it could go down, so you just have to be very cautious about that. With that being said, that was, you know, kind of the opening range. The stock gapped up, traded completely sideways in consolidation, the stock, you know, the opening bell rings, stock sells down, we start moving up. This would be my entry point. As soon as we break above the pre-market highs or that level it's been holding, I would have had an entry ready to go right here. I would have went long, sold on the move up, you know, maybe got out somewhere up here for a 17-16% move. You could have even held all the way to the high of this, and then as soon as you could have just held all the way up. And then if you really wanted to, you could just wait until you've seen your first red candle and bailed, okay? Now, this stock could have had a pullback, but it failed to do so, okay? This thing failed to have a pullback, okay? This would have been its real first pullback, but this is a real bad pullback. You get 3 red candles, and then your first 5-minute candle to make its new high, it goes, but it only goes for 6%. So if you played that, the first 5-minute candle to break the high of the red, you could have played a scalp move for about 6-7% if you were really quick, okay? So that's something you could have done, you know, and it was right here. You know, you had this right here. This is exactly where it was on the 1-minute chart. Stock broke above, and you get that 7% move up to the high. So you could have played that for a quick scalp, And if you noticed on the 1 minute chart, so let's step back. If you played the pullback on here, you were looking for the first 5 minute chart to make a new high above its previous red, letting you know that we're starting to beat over and starting to do a little trend reversal. So if you play the first 5 minute candle to make a new high, you would have got in somewhere right here. And if you look on the 1 minute chart, you would have noticed that right where it started to break above, you had it break its volume weighted average price, which is the dotted line right there. You would have noticed you were getting a VWAP breakout, and it was also starting to make new highs above its previous sell-off or above its previous 5 minute candle. So that's another reason why it's very important to consistently have your 5 minute charts up and your 1 minute charts up, so that way you know exactly what you're looking at and you're not missing moves. So that's enough of ANY. We're going to hop over to, does this mean we can see you live during trading days? Joe, to answer your question, does this mean we can see you live during your trading days? I believe so. I believe that's what we're going to do now. So now that I think about it, we can go live. I can start, going live during my trading days, going live during pre-market. So maybe we'll just start implementing this as I plan to do with YouTube. As some of you know and some of you may not know, YouTube won't allow me to do live videos until I have 10,000 subscribers. So we got a ways to go till then. But for now, I can use Facebook Live and a program I have on my computer called OBS to record my screen and record my my trading pre-market and into the day. And then once it's done, I can upload those videos to YouTube for anybody who didn't catch them. We'll implement something like that. We can talk about that a little more here in the future. For now, we're going to go over to FNJN, and then we'll finish it up with OPXAW, and then we'll go into a few questions that you guys have. So FNJN. This is another one that recently made some moves just on Friday, I believe it was. Let me zoom in for you guys. Okay, so FNJN, and like I always say, pre-market, I'm looking for things that are moving, things that are up, high on percent. Are they up a significant amount of percent? Are they up trading on a lot of volume? Well, for one, this thing wasn't really trading on any volume, and it wasn't really up pre-market very much. It was up like a couple percent, I think it was that day. But I believe it did have news out on it Friday. If I open up the news scanner 620, I can't remember exactly why I was watching this one. But either way, I can't remember exactly why I was watching it. It wasn't due to news, I know exactly why I was watching it. This is why I was watching it. This stock started making moves on Thursday, right? It went up from 326 to 350, and it went up 9% right at the end of the day. And I noticed that it made some moves, so I was looking for the stock to continue that momentum into the trading day. That's why I was watching it. Okay, so the stock made, so that's another thing I'll do. I'll look for stocks that are, that may have been to it. Yeah, okay. Or it was in our group chat. There you go, Johnny. So there's some people in our group chat. Maybe that's why I was watching it too. He did alert it, now that I think about it. He did alert the stock, so that was to Victor, who is in our group chat. He was the one who alerted the stock to us and had us put on the watch. And so this would have been the entry point on it right here. The stock wasn't moving up high, pre-market. But, that's okay. We had it on our watch. We were taking a look at it. So I wouldn't have traded right out of the bell because there isn't much to go off pre-market. This thing could have went either way. But the perfect entry point would have been when you've seen the stock move up right out of pre-market at the opening bell, it shot up. This is your entry right here, your first. Now, this is the difference, okay? Before, I was going off of five-minute pullbacks, and here's when you get a one-minute pullback, right? So if you go to the right hand and you look at the screen on the right, this is the five-minute chart. On the five-minute chart, you just have one big green candle, okay? You have no clear indicator of any entry because the five-minute candle isn't giving you any entry point information. There is no pullback here. You would not see it if you were just trading a one-minute or a five-minute chart. But if you were to go over and you were trading on a one-minute chart, you would have noticed the one-minute micro pullback. And that occurs right here. So you get the move out of the gates, then your 1 minute candle sells off, and then your next 1 minute candle starts to break above the previous red candle. So as soon as you get a break, your next green candle to break the previous red candle, you make a new high, that's your entry point, and you could have rode this up for a quick 8% move. The trade you would have been in would have only been for about 2 minutes, so you had to be real quick, okay? You had to be very quick, because if you didn't get out, you would have got caught in this swift move down, and that, you know, would have lost you majority of your game. So like I said, especially trading 1 minute charts, you're going to have to be very quick when you put your orders in and when you put your orders out. Okay, so that was explaining just a 1 minute pullback. As we noticed, a pullback could be one red candle, it could be two, it could be three, it could be four, but you really want to see the next green candle to start making new highs above your previous red candles, and that's going to signify that we're starting to move upwards and we're making new highs over our previous reds. Very quick, I lost and I won't be featherless off. So, for example, there you go, John. So Johnny here, he's in the group chat. I think he said he lost money on this because he was very slow. And I just got over, you know, explaining that that's super important, that you have to be quick. Johnny's been trading for a year. He's super good. He personally likes to short stocks. I like to go long on stocks. But he knows a ton of stuff. We've been just recently connected and started talking. But he knows his stuff. And for example, he specifically just said that he lost a little bit of money on this trade because he was slow. And if you think about it, if your entry point was right here, basically on the top of this 1 minute candle, you only have 1-2 minutes to, you know, fight or flight. You're gonna hold or you're gonna sell. If you held, you get caught in this swift move down on this huge candle, and then you basically just stopped out or you lost. If you got in real quick or your order got executed slow. So you have to be real quick. Okay? Now we're gonna move over to OPXAW, which I know for a fact a lot of you're familiar with. Okay, look at this thing. Look at this thing rip. Okay, I'm gonna go back into I think a 90-day chart here. 1 second. So I'm gonna go into a 90-day, 1 hour chart so you can understand what I drew out. A while back, I mean, who knows? This is about 2 months ago, maybe. 2 months ago, my friend, he played this stock on this day, you know, right in this time frame, and he made a good amount of money on it. Once I knew that this stock was a really low-priced stock and it made some moves, I personally drew some trend lines to give me a better picture as when this thing might spike, right? So we had this sell-off, we had this move up. So I started to draw trend lines basically going from the tops of all their peaks and just basically following the trend, and this starts to give me, as you can see, this little triangle pattern, this pennant. This is what we call a pennant. It's giving me this upward pennant, I guess you could say. And basically what I would be looking for, as soon as the stock starts forming into the end of this triangle, is it going to break up and go above, or is it going to break down and go below? If it breaks up above the upward trend line, or the downward pennant trend line, then you're looking at a move up. But I'm not going to go too much into that. I want to go right into the actual daily chart. Oh, and also, here's another thing. Once I knew that this stock made moves up, I basically drew, and it's as simple as this, I basically drew a trend line from the tops, you know, their very high price point, you know, their peaks of where they sold to. I drew it all the way across and said, hey, if this stock can break above that trend line, I would look to go long. And sure enough, if we go into a 1 day, 1 minute chart, you'll see just that. I'm going to a 10 day, 1 minute, but now, if I go into a 10-day, 1-minute chart, you'll see that those trend lines I drew are exactly where the stock broke out. And these were drawn. I drew these lines like, I didn't just draw them. I drew these lines, honestly, I drew them maybe a month ago. And sure enough, these were my trend lines were drawn a month ago, and look where the stock broke out. I wasn't even trading this day. I think I actually took off to go to work, or I basically was not trading this day. Oh, you know what happened? I wasn't paying attention to the stock this day, and my scanners are not set for this stock price this low. I scanned for 30 cents or higher, and the stock was priced way below 30 cents, so I didn't get notified when it started to move, and that was my fault for not paying attention to it closely. But if we go into it a little bit more, so let's see, hold on 1 second. It would be very interesting to see how you guys actually get in and out of a position because of there are quite a few ways to do that with TOS. Okay, so Andrell, I currently don't even trade on TOS. I mean, I guess I can go into showing you a few ways to get in and out of trades. But right now, I'm kind of focusing on a lot of beginners that are working with Robinhood. But I mean, I guess I could do that at some point. I'll look into doing that for you. But now if we go into OPXAW, and I zoom in a little more, they're kind of hard to see because of all my trend lines, so let me get those off of here. So you can see where the arrows are pointing to, and if I zoom in on the 5-minute chart, it becomes much more clear. So on your 1-minute chart, you don't have a clear entry point. Yeah, the stock's moving up, but for a lot of people, they wouldn't really be able to tell exactly when to get in. But I mean, I always teach that you can just get in on the breakout. So if you just played the once the price broke above its previous high, that would be an entry point, and sure enough, you'd ride up. Or once the stock breaks above this previous high, you could get in, and you catch this huge ride up. But if you look on a 5-minute chart, it's much more obvious. You have a clear, distinct pullback happening. Okay, let me zoom out a little bit more. So an OPXA made a huge move on Friday. If you're trading the 1-minute chart, it wouldn't have been as easy to catch. If you're watching the stock on a 5-minute chart, you would have easily been able to notice the pullback. Okay, it goes up, then you get sell-off. Now my entry point would be the first 5-minute candle to start making a new high, which had been right here. It's now making highs above its previous red candle. I would go long. You could catch this move up, and just this move alone was 30% move. Okay, so you could have caught that move up, and then your next entry would have been as soon as your 5-minute candles break above the previous high of the last red, and this would have been your entry point, and then you could have rode this all the way up. Sold. If you sold on the peak, you were looking at a 300% move. If you sold early, you would have been somewhere in here. And of course, it comes down to being able to read level twos and stuff like that to know when to get in and out of a trade. But for now, we're just kind of going over the pullbacks, okay? Just simple patterns on charts you may start to recognize to give you guys an exact way of entering into a stock. That way you can become a little bit more profitable. Of course, there's tons of stuff that goes into it still. You know, as far as is there volume? Of course you need volume. Okay, here's another thing, right? So you get the spike up. You get the spike off, sells off. Look at the volume. The volume starts to decrease. The volume starts to come back right here because people recognize that the candles are starting to make new highs above the previous red, and we're starting to form an upward momentum bull flat or a pullback. Volume comes back, right? Red candles. Volume decreases. Volume doesn't go up on the red candles, signifying a huge sell-off. The volume goes down on the red candles. Okay? So that's a good sign. Guess what? We're starting to make new highs on the 5-minute candles. Volume comes back. Now you have killer volume. Boom. You get that huge run-up. So like I said, these are just simple pullback patterns that I think after enough of these videos and maybe enough of these live streams, you guys will start to pick up on, so that way you can catch them intraday. Yes, like Johnny said, first and second pullbacks are usually the ones you want to trade. The third pullbacks are usually pretty risky because you've already had such a big move up a lot of the times that the third ones just don't go through very well. ANY was one that I guess you could say may have been an anomaly because that had a few good pullbacks on it. But Johnny Matrix, he is completely right in the group chat there on the side. Playing the third pullback can be very risky because you've already had such a good move up that the third one usually just doesn't have the follow through that the first two pullbacks do. So be cautious when trying to trade a third pullback. If you miss the first one, you have a second one a lot of the times. It's a little bit risky to trade the third one. So, you know, that's up to you how you want to, you know, go about doing that. Okay. So there you go for the pullbacks. We'll do some more live videos on some other stuff here. So I just want to go over those three stocks that were in the past week that I noticed, you know, right offhand that had good charts and good patterns on their charts, so that that way you guys can start getting an idea of it. And hopefully you can start catching them in real time. So if any of you guys like, I guess now would be the perfect time to, you know, spit out some questions in the chat. Maybe Johnny Matrix can help jump in, and then, you know, we can start going over some questions any of you guys have. So, I plan on going for about an hour on the live video, but I mean, if nobody has any questions, I mean, then you must all be some pretty fast learners, and that's fantastic. But, if you guys got some questions, please, now is the time, spit them out in the chat if you guys are still in here. Like I said, Johnny can help answer them, I can help answer them, and hopefully we can get everybody caught up to speed on trading as quickly as possible. Okay, Giant says, let's take a look at RWLK. Let me pop on some studies onto this guy here real quick. Edit studies, strategy, or sets, indicators, and select it. What the? Come on. There you go. Okay. Anthony, do you save your Facebook Live so we can go back and watch later? So, Anthony, I am currently recording this, or at least I think I am. This would be my first time doing it, but I'm pretty sure I'm actually recording this video, and it will be posted to YouTube, so that way you can go back and watch it if you missed some stuff, or anybody can go back and watch some stuff. All right, Johnny, let's look at the daily chart. I'm going to go down to a one chart. We're going to go over to daily. Oop, there we go. Okay, so I think what Johnny's getting at with looking at RWLK is the fact that on its one-year daily chart, and if I'm wrong, you can more than happily correct me, Johnny, but I think what we're looking at here is the fact that it's been downtrending for over the past year. If you're looking at the one-year daily chart, it's been downtrending for over the past year. It recently bottomed out at $1.10. We're now sitting up super significantly at $2.43. So from its low to its, you know, now high, it's up about 50%. I think what Johnny's looking at here is we can get some continued momentum upwards. And when you're looking at a one-year daily chart, once it breaks through its 100-day moving average, your typical next target would be all the way up to your 200-day moving average, which is a 37% move. Am I correct, Johnny? Are we looking at past 5-7 days? Oh, past 5-7 days. All right, let's go into that. Okay, 5 days. Oh, wait, Johnny, do you want me to go to a 5-7-day chart, or do you just want me to talk about its past couple days on the one-year day chart? Let's get usable to 5-minute. All right, so we'll just go into this real quick. So looking at the stock from a one-year, one-day time frame, once it bottoms out, you're really looking to see, is this stock going to make, is it going to break above its 100-day moving average? If so, and it gets a clean break above it, now we would look to go long with a possible target of the 200-day moving average. If you're just now getting on, you still have to be a little cautious because, you know, it's only got, I mean, it's gotten 20% up until the 200-day moving average, but a lot of times stocks like this will get a lot of resistance around that 200-day moving average. So it's good when you're trading to also have a 1-day 1-minute, 1-day 5-minute, and a one-year day chart, so you can see exactly where you rest at below the 200-day moving average on a one-year chart. think this should be on the list for tomorrow. I definitely agree that this should be on the list for tomorrow. I was looking at it on Friday when it was making moves, and then, but yeah, for the most part, I think this should definitely be on the list for tomorrow. So anybody watching live, keep RWLK on your watch list for tomorrow. Let's see, what else we got here? Coming in late. Just talking about the past couple of days. All right, so let's go into a five-day, five-minute chart. Okay, so if you looked on the one-year date, actually, you know what I'll do? I'll open up my trading grid. Everybody, this is exactly what my trading screen looks like when I'm trading live in the day. Okay? Not on FNJ, on RWLK. This is what my trading screen looks like. If you like it, cool, you can use it. On the right-hand corner right here, I have time and sales along with news. So I want to know if our trades and shares, level 2, and I'll have news up in this bottom right. On the bottom left, I'll have the one-year day chart. That way I can see, you know, where do I rest at on a one-year time frame? Am I below the 200-day moving average? Am I above the 200-day moving average? And then I have my one-minute chart, and I have a five-minute chart. So if we go into a five-day, five-minute time frame on RWLK, it's got a clean uptrend. I mean, you know, it flattened out right here, but for the most part, we're uptrending. I actually want to go to, let's do a 10-day, five-minute. Okay, so for 10 days, we're on an uptrend. There's a couple breakouts you could have played on this guy, you know, like right in here. This stock moved up today, that day. It looked like it started gapping up in the pre-market hours, came down. So here's a good one. Okay, so this is where a stock gapped up, sold off. It kind of created a pullback in a sense through the pre-market hours, but didn't really create one. So I would have looked to go long over the pre-market high, which would have been right here, okay? So this would have been one, you know, you could have gotten in once the stock broke above its pre-market high, which was really right here, sorry. So look at, okay, here's a great example, actually, and I'm glad Johnny brought up this stock. So if you're looking at this stock on this particular day, it started gapping up pre-market, it reached a high of 155, and then it sold off, and then right out of the gates, it came back up. It tested 155 one time, two times, three times it tested that 155 mark before it got a clean breakout and a move up to 182, okay? So that's what I like to trade. Me personally, I love trading breakouts. To other people, they may be a little bit more challenging, but to me, they're such a simple concept to grasp your head around or the idea of them because you're just looking for a stock to break out and make new highs above previous highs. Above previous three-month highs. So they're really, personally, I feel one of the most profitable ways to trade. So like this one here, you could have basically just said, hey, I'm going to get in on the stock once it breaks above its pre-market high. And guess what happened? Once the stock broke above its pre-market high, you had this nice follow-through. Another reason why the follow-through was so clean on this is because it tested it three times in a row before it got that break. So that tells you right there was a lot of people waiting for that breakout because it tested three times. That was showing a strong resistance point. Not just once, but twice and three times it showed strong resistance. So if you can get a break above that, you're showing a nice breakout there. And sure enough, that breakout was all the way to the tippy top, about a 14-cent move. Or not 14-cent, but 14% move. Okay, 14% in less than 2 minutes. Because the candle opened up here, breakout happened here, then we moved up here. So in less than 2 minutes, your trade would have been less than 2 minutes. You would have been trading for maybe a minute and 25, minute and 30 seconds before you would have sold. Okay, so that is how quick some of these trades become. I think this, and it became support. Oh, yeah. Okay, great. Yeah, thanks, John. For example, when prices break out, their old resistance lines become support lines. So like Johnny in the chat just mentioned, and I'm glad he did, he's got there watching my back on and stuff. But like he said, old resistance lines become support. And how is that? It just is what it is. They just do that. Okay, and if you look, if you follow and I draw another line, look where the stock bottomed out at. It came up, you had your breakout, then you had your sell-off. Look at the stock bounced on the previous breakout or previous resistance line. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 times on a 5-minute chart. But do you notice that? You see that support that it created, and then you get a bounce up, okay? You got another bounce up, and now this thing just starts trending upwards, right? And here's another good thing to look for is when stocks hold their highs going into the next day, they can become players for the next day. So if we keep going along, you know, this thing kind of sold off a little bit, and then we had a breakout here. So let's see if we can find out why this stock broke out. I think this was Friday. So let's see if we can find out why this stock broke out Friday. What are we noticing here? Okay, so looking at it from this picture, there's something you could have played pretty simply, which was its last high, the very high. So you could have played a breakout here. But if you did that, you would have missed a big chunk of the move. So what you could have done is played the breakout over the past couple days, which would have been right here. And also, here's another thing. Look at on the 5-minute chart. On the 5-minute chart, this stock likes to hold support on the 200-day moving average. That's another thing with moving averages, okay? Moving averages act as support and resistance. When a stock falls below the moving averages now become resistance. When the stock is trading above moving averages, the moving averages act as support. So as you can see right in here, you had sell-off that basically just tanked through all the moving averages, but the 200-day moving average act as a strong support. Stock bounced off it here, came down, sold below it a little bit, bounced up, started trading on it, and now we get a move up, okay? So I think this move up maybe would have been based on, maybe there was some news, it's hard to tell now exactly, but you could have played some of these breakout patterns right here. Like if you played the previous, you know, previous high, you could have played the breakout to the high of the day, which would have been a 16-17% move. If you would have played the breakout, let's see, what was it doing pre-market? Oh, there's a good sign. That I missed. I didn't get in here close enough. But here in pre-market, it gapped up. That's what it did. In pre-market, it gapped up about 10%. So it gapped up 10%. So I would have looked to go in long over its high. But see, it did it right here. The stock broke above its high. But on the first candle, it's always a little risky to do that. So if you would have waited, you actually could see that there's a pullback occurring right here. So you get up here, and it just starts creating this flat top, maybe a flat top breakout, you could call it, not really a pullback. But as soon as you get this first 5-minute candle, the break above the highs of its previous red, you could go long. Simple as that. Kind of back to the bull flag, flat top breakout idea there. I did a chart for the past few days. Okay, so like Johnny said, it broke out because of the daily chart for the past few days, which it looked like I just kind of went over. It is what it is. So bull flags, or not bull flags, but, you know, looking at charts, you need to start being able to recognize pullbacks and, like, little intraday breakouts, and those are always going to be really strong plays for you guys. So with that being said, I think we're going to kind of recap that there, and kind of stop it there with any more analyzing of some stocks. If you guys would like to ask a few questions before I do get off, I would more than happily do that. So right now is the time to shoot any questions you guys have, and let me know. So I'll hang on here for maybe another couple minutes, see if we can start getting some questions. Okay, so yeah, with Jay Young, get rich or die grinding, that's kind of how Ross trades. So yeah, a lot of you may be familiar with, you know, the way, you know, he trades, but, you know, for example, we're just getting a lot of this out here live, for free. Tons of traders trade the same way, so I think I'm going to end it there. I might edit this a little bit, but for the most part, this should be uploaded to Facebook, or not Facebook, but YouTube. So I hope a lot of you guys liked it and enjoyed the time here. We're going to consistently do more and more of these, and probably going to start implementing a little bit of Johnny Matrix in the loop here as much as we can, because, like I said, he knows a lot about what he's doing, and it's cool having him on the side here and on here with the team of me. So with that being said, I'm going to end it there. And hope you guys had a good night, and I hope this helped you guys.
Peace.